Kia ora tātou and welcome to a chat with Lutra. I'm Caroline, a principal engineer at Lutra, and I am here with Salma Rayan, who is the water engineering services manager with Dana, and Ash Deshpande, who is a principal wastewater engineer at Lutra. And today we are tackling the fascinating topic of biosolids, those delightful little solids you get at the end of a wastewater treatment process after you have processed what comes into the plant. So Ash, tell us, what is a biosolid exactly?
That's exactly what it is, what you just said. it's essentially a solid particles coming out of the processing of the wastewater through a treatment plant. And what is left, what you settle as sludge, that biosolids, we call it biosolids because it's comes out of a secondary treatment process. So it's a mixture of biomass plus all the inert solids. That's what is essentially biosolids.
And because all of our wastewater treatment processes are biologically based in New Zealand for the best part, we get a lot of it. And so we need to do something with it. Why is it a problem?
Technology has moved quite a bit, and technologically we can do a lot of things. It's not about technology. Cost is one issue. I think even the overall management of that coordination is an issue. So if we get all of those things aligned, then I think we can solve a lot of the problems. And we haven't recognized that too much as a resource. You know, it's a top resource, just in terms of, you know, Salma will tell you what it is about. But we haven't in New Zealand yet, we haven't recognized that.
Yeah.
Put that into good use.
Because they're obviously biological based, which means they contain a lot of the good stuff that makes us up, water and nutrients. And Salma, you gave a really great paper at the recent Water New Zealand conference where you talked about New Zealand's landfill loving problem, which is the main disposal avenue for our biosolids in New Zealand. So why is this a problem?
Yeah, well, like Ash was implying, we have 360 wastewater treatment plants, but plus 100 more smaller treatment plants. And we produce hundreds of tons of biosolids every year, or sludge. And biosolids or sludge is just like fuel or wood, so it can be repurposed as an alternative source of fuel or a fertilizer. And despite this renewable resource, we throw most of it away, well over 60%. And if you include the quarry landfill, it's more like 80%. Compare that with Australia, you have 75% of Australia's biosolids are actually reused for agricultural purposes. So this is not just one country, there's many countries in the world that recognize biosolids as a valuable resource and create this great economy where you have continuous waste into something that can be reused. And we just don't take that opportunity in New Zealand, even though we can. And like Ash said, it's not a technology problem. There's plenty of technology available, but it's more of a history and a cultural problem. And I am starting to see a bit of a change here. Are you seeing this with your clients or?
Maybe bigger clients, but I think if you go to the regions, they still don't think about, reusing power solids, or they just think about disposing it at the cheapest way they can. So I don't think on a regional level in the rural areas there.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately a big driver of that in New Zealand, disposal to landfill is cheap. Mm. I think the last time I looked at it, it's probably more now, it's like $60 a ton, whereas Australia could be $200, $300 a ton. So if it's cheap to throw away, you're likely to go that way.
And one of the problems with biosolids in landfill is that it tends to degrade and produce a lot of methane. There are a few landfills in New Zealand that do capture the methane, but obviously as it starts degrading and producing these greenhouse gases, it's not very good for our carbon emissions. Mm-hmm. Now, Salma, you've just worked on a great project that was specifically targeted towards reducing carbon emissions, among several other things. And this was a project in Loganholme, in Australia, the development of a biosolids gasification plant. Now, this is quite a large plant, I believe. How many population did it serve?
Yeah, so I wish I worked on it. I'm more just spreading the word about our awesome team in Downer, Australia. Downer, Australia, they have a group within them. It's an engineering services group, and they are part of the operation and maintenance deal with a council in Brisbane called Loganholme. And in this city, it's about 350,000 people, population-wise, so quite similar to Christchurch. And they were producing 34,000 tons of waste-activated sludge a year. And every single day from this plant, you'd have six truckloads traveling 300 kilometers around the country just to throw it away. It was costing them a hell of a lot. It was about 30% of their operating cost just to deal with the volume of sludge. So from an operational point of view, they really wanted to reduce that cost, but they also have a very strong environmental policy to reduce carbon emission, which was a big thing for them. And also probably the most important, well, top three anyway, was Queensland started applying limits to certain organic contaminants, such as PFAS and microplastics and things like that. It was particularly a PFAS limit to their biosolid application. So because in Australia they apply biosolids to land, Logan City Council had to deal with 34,000 tons of biosolids, and all of a sudden this PFAS limit was being applied. And so a technology or a process had to be developed such that we could reduce the volume significantly and therefore reduce the operating costs, but to also address PFAS and microplastics. So lots of biosolid management technologies exist. It's not a new thing. As you mentioned, Ash, sludge dewatering and sludge drying will reduce biosolids by 90%. So that ticks your operational requirement, but not much has actually been demonstrated for domestic biosolid to remove your nasties, such as PFAS and microplastics. So Downer went down the journey of demonstrating a process. So you had your dewatering, you have your drying, all good, and then you have to find some kind of process to knock out PFAS and to a level that is predictable, and you could actually reproduce it again after a trial. So they actually partnered up with a company called Pyrocal, and they are gasifier specialists. And I believe they were very much involved in food waste mostly and degrading biomass that you couldn't with other standard technologies. Anyway, so the gasifier essentially looks like an elevator. I can't explain it better than that. It's, I don't know, 2 meters high, 1.5 meter wide, and it has rings. And your biosolids go on top of the top two rings, and the top two rings are heated to 650 degrees with no oxygen, so forming pyrolysis. So that breaks down the biosolids, and in here that's where it becomes organically biodegraded. And then at the bottom ring, you get an air of injection and you get a gas phase reaction or gasification. And in this reaction, you actually burn off PFAS, microplastics, etc. It was really interesting. I found this more gross than anything, but they actually had to see what the biosolid was coming in, what was in it. And they found that it was a manual process. So I feel really bad who was
manual
the person
process.
Who did this.
Just imagine.
Yeah. They found that per gram of sludge, they found six pieces of microplastics. Like glitter, anything is less than 5 microns. Lots. And they and where that comes from in wastewater is actually, you know, our clothes, you're probably wearing something polyestery or plasticky. When you wash it, a lot of these fibers come out. And it's something crazy, like per load of wash, it was 600,000 fibers. So if you can imagine how many loads you do a week over your population, etc.
Yeah.
So that gasifier destroyed between 90 to 100% of the incoming PFAS, which was, you know, I didn't see them, but I suspect you'd be dancing if you see a result like that. And it destroyed also 60% of the microplastics overall. The bigger the plastics were, the easier it was to burn off. And the trial they did, they actually put in a mini version of the full-scale plant, and the existing plant didn't actually have dewatering or drying set up, so they had to import about 200 tons of biosolids from two neighboring plants. And so that variability kind of affected the results a little bit, but nonetheless it was demonstrated largely successful and justified a business case to then build the full scale that was commissioned and running in March 2022.
So it's brand new.
I'm really interested to see how it goes for the next few years. I suspect it's going to get better and better and better as we learn more things.
So that's really exciting because it is brand new. It's not been done before.
Yeah.
You invested, or the client invested in a real proof of concept in that pilot plant.
Yeah.
So what really were their drivers for going out on a limb and saying they were going to do this? Was it just that PFAS limit?
No, so they really had to do something about their operations. It was costing them a lot. They needed to do something. I think it was $1.8 million a year or so, just one plant, that's a lot. The second thing, it was that PFAS limit. There was literally no off-the-shelf technology that could guarantee that. So they had to do something quick. And thirdly, the council themselves have a very strong, like almost aggressive drive to get to net carbon zero.
Okay.
So back to your carbon emission question, as part of the trial, they also wanted to see carbon emission differences between if they had continued what they were doing as they were, so business as usual, versus putting in a gasifier. So they went out and they got a consultant to do the theoretical, and they based it on 2029, what the sludge would be produced then, and they compared the two. So they factored in the actual gasification process, if it did anything. The savings in gas emissions with 90% less trucking. And then they also looked at the savings from not applying to land. So when you apply to land, you produce carbon dioxide. Anyway, they found that that year versus 2029, if they put in a gasifier, they'd reduce carbon emission by 40%. And then that gasifier, through that chemical process alone, reduced carbon emission by 20 to 25% just through that.
So that's a big help.
That's huge. The gasifier did more in knocking out carbon emission than reducing truckage by 90%.
Yeah, that's impressive.
So it was very surprising.
Left with a biologically inert, completely sterile.
Yep.
Is it just a carbon char?
So it looks very much like charcoal, but it is something that's filled with nutrients. It's carbon, nitrogen, it's about 4% free phosphorus. So it's very much a soil amendment. And then another part of the process, they had to see what you could do with the thing, if you could actually essentially make money out of it. And they found there were sort of top three available options. First of all, you could sell it in the agricultural space as a soil amendment. And I think at that time, that it was about $40 a ton. The numbers will vary, obviously. But you could also sell it as a fuel source, a 20 joule per ton fuel source. That was like $260 a ton. And anyway, the numbers could be different now. But another third thing is, because you could reduce carbon emission, you could also sell carbon credits as on the international market. So you effectively sell it twice as a good fertilizer fuel source that's sterile, clean, has nutrients, but also as a carbon credit. So it was very much a good money maker potential. As of today's recording, I think they're looking at two or three other plants.
Okay.
And from that plant, more councils got interested.
Yeah.
And in fact, I think there's a few councils in New Zealand that are interested in this option. But it is a big cost. It wasn't, a cheap thing to do.
So the other plants would be at similarly sized cities that you're looking at?
And smaller. And bigger.
Okay. How small is it economic?
Yeah. So the population I was given was 20,000 people.
Okay.
Less than that, you start losing the benefits a little bit in terms of what you put in versus what you get out. But in New Zealand, one of our, compared to Australia anyway, we have a small population and it's scattered. But there are also areas in New Zealand where this kind of technology would lean very well. Places that already have a dryer, so you only need to add a gasifier.
Yeah.
So New Plymouth, Christchurch, both are good examples. Then there's places where landfill disposal is getting harder and harder and harder, so it makes sense to invest in reducing your volumes. So places like that are like Otago, even Wellington. But then we could also put in centralized biosolid plants, such as a gasifier, for surrounding townships. And I probably see a lot of opportunities in New Zealand like that.
Yeah, and that's one of the major potential benefits from water reform.
Yep.
Is that the investment in centralized facilities might actually become a lot more feasible.
Yep.
So we could see neighboring councils join together and use their biosolids, you know, into a common facility, even expand into co-digestion of other wastes, that sort of thing. So you don't have to rely on this large population base to get all of those benefits.
Yeah.
But at the moment, it's pretty difficult. Ash, in your experience, you know, around the regions, what are the two most common ways people deal with their biosolids?
Landfill, geobags and landfill.
Geobags and landfill.
Yeah, that's pretty common. I mean, some of the councils do have thickening, dewatering to reduce the transport cost to the landfill, but very little processing or degradation steps.
Do you think organic contaminants or even things like plastics and PFAS is even being thought of right now?